all the things we know of as properties of the cancer cell can be traced to the malfunction of genes. That in turn has raised the possibility of very, very precise therapeutics. Because if you can identify the malfunctioning genes in any individual tumor, you can, in principle, devise a therapeutic that specifically targets that malfunction. And we call this targeted therapy. Actually, the very first example was in breast cancer many years ago, when it was discovered that the estrogen receptor, the molecule that the hormone estrogen binds to and that leads to the effect of estrogen on breast tissue, that if you inhibited that, you would have a favorable effect on many breast cancers. And it turned out that these breast cancers were expressing the estrogen receptor. Those that didn't express the estrogen receptor did not respond to the therapeutic. So that's a 30-year-old version of targeted therapy. Flash forward to our current knowledge about the malfunctioning genes of cancer cells. The next triumph was with a relatively rare disease known as chronic myeloid leukemia. This was an inevitably fatal disease. The standard chemotherapeutics had marginal utility with the disease. And we knew that there was a particular malfunctioning gene in those leukemia cells. And working with a drug company, a young medical scientist named Brian Drucker demonstrated that an existing therapeutic that was on the shelf, not being used, was effective against that malfunctioning gene that was common to all chronic myeloid leukemia. And the very first tests of that therapeutic with patients with chronic myeloid leukemia had what I would call a Lazarus effect. I mean, patients were on their deathbed and literally stood up within days of getting this therapeutic and walked out of the hospital. It was astonishing. And we have other examples now. What we need is a complete catalog of those genetic malfunctions in various kinds of cancer that are common enough to create therapeutics that can then be ready to go for any individual patient. We need the ability for every hospital to test every individual tumor for all the genetic malfunctions for which we have therapeutics. And we're rapidly approaching that capability. The information in our genes is encoded by an alphabet of four molecules called nucleotides. And it's a simple alphabet, which the order in which the letters are arranged encode all the functions of a cell. The first time that that order was determined, it cost a huge amount of money and took a long time to do, years. Now it can be done in a day for less than $1,000. We call this complete genome sequencing. The genome is a term that simply refers to the entire genetic information contained in a cell. Right now, most advanced cancer centers will either determine the complete sequence of that alphabet in the genome of a patient's cancer cell. You compare that to the genome from their normal cells, and you can spot any genetic malformation that gives rise to a malfunction. So you get a readout of potential targets for therapeutics. This is a work in progress. And the biggest impediment to a completion of the project is data analysis. The data are accumulating more rapidly than the bioinformaticists can decipher it. What's the catch here? The catch here is a very old and daunting enemy, and that's called drug resistance. Sooner or later, even with an exquisitely targeted therapy, such as the one I described for chronic myeloid leukemia, the original drug is called Gleevec, and it was truly a miracle drug. Sooner or later, the tumors develop resistance. The first therapeutic works for a while, and then you have to have another one. That works for a while, and you have to have another one. Now, why is this happening? And the reason this is happening is something that we did not appreciate until very recently. And that is, if you take a large tumor that's got trillions of cells in it, and you look at the individual cells, which we can now do, if you look at them one by one for the order of the alphabet in their genome, I think it's safe to say that no two cells in a tumor are exactly alike genetically. The differences may be very small, but they're not exactly alike. That means that there are a trillion possibilities for a particular form of drug resistance to be lurking in the mass of a tumor. So you kill off 99.9% of the cells, and what's left? That rare cell in which the resistance to the drug has already developed simply by genetic accident. It's simple, just random genetic variation, which creates this incredible, what we call heterogeneity, tumor heterogeneity. This is only recently appreciated, and it is a daunting challenge. And we don't quite know how to deal with it yet. How do we deal with tumor heterogeneity? Because until then, we are going to have this relentless treadmill. And one approach, of course, is a time-honored mechanism, what we call combination therapy. So some tumors have been cured with conventional chemotherapy by combining several drugs at one time. We think we know how that works, but we also know it doesn't always work. And sooner or later, the patients who have responded even to combination therapy die of their disease. That's the great present challenge. How do we deal with this extraordinary heterogeneity? That brings onto the scene immunotherapy. Immunotherapy is different because it's not a chemical. Like chemotherapy or like targeted therapy we talked about. Immunotherapy utilizes either immune cells or the antibodies made by immune cells to either unleash the immune system to kill tumor cells. One by one means or another unleashes the immune system to kill tumor cells. Well, there's nothing new under the sun after a fashion. This works in some people and not in others, and it works for a while, and with a few exceptions, ultimately it fails because of resistance. And the resistance is distinctive from the kind that occurs for targeted pharmacological therapy. But it is, again, of a sort that can arise spontaneously in that lonely cell amongst the trillion of a tumor. It appears that some tumors have this in advance of receiving immunotherapy. Others it appears later after you've killed off much of the tumors. Now, can we combine immunotherapy with the pharmacological targeted therapy? Absolutely. This is all very recent. So this is just now underway. And how effective it will be remains to be seen. You're coming at the tumor in two very different ways, and that's good. How efficacious it will be remains to be seen. It's too early to know.